just driving so fast. I black out. I hit two cars. I banged my head on the windshield, and in a daze, I hit even harder on the gas. And I go up and I hit a house going 100 kilometers an hour. So I ejected out of the vehicle head first. And from that instance, I left my body. And right when I hit that house, it was like a bomb went off. And I started hearing voices immediately. Like, what was that? Wake up. And I hear people going down the stairs. But I was done. My body was done. And I didn't realize what it was, but it was my spirit was out of my body, and I was able to listen and observe and notice.
I'd like to welcome to the show Malcolm Nair. How you doing, Malcolm?
Fantastic.
Thank you so much for coming on the show, my friend, and sharing your story with us.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Good. So we're going to talk a little bit about your near-death experience, what happened during that process, and what happened afterwards, more importantly. But before we get into that, what was your life like prior to having a near-death experience?
I share this story so much. I want to have a different approach today.
Okay.
But before my car accident, so let me share how I grew up. I grew up as a, I was self-sabotaged. I grew up in a broken home. My parents, they divorced when I was 1 year old. And my mom was in an abusive relationship with my father. And she ended up leaving him when I was 1 year old. So my mom moved to Vancouver, British Columbia. And I grew up in Richmond, BC, New West, and then downtown Vancouver, Hastings. So down there, it was Campbell and Hastings, East Hastings. So the BC housings, it's the projects. And I grew up kind of, around a lot of scarcity, a lot of drugs, a lot of abuse, and negativity. So growing up, I would visit my father, you know, every 3 months out of the year. And it was torment. Like, I remember it being like rules and regulations. I wasn't allowed home even by a minute. If I was late, I would get beat up. And I'm talking about, like, you know, belts, wooden spoons, metal spoons. And so I was always told, you know, how dumb I am and how I would be like, you know, my mother, or I'd be a loser. Like, I don't know if I can swear on your podcast, but I was called a lot of bad names. And sure. So growing up in that environment was very hard for me. And so by the time I was about 9-10 years old, I've already went to eight different schools. And as I got older, I started working when I was about 15 years old, but every job that I worked for, I was fired from. And I worked probably over 100 jobs. You know, I've moved into over 100 homes. There was 1 year I counted that I moved 25 times in 1 year by myself. By the time I was 15, I was homeless. I was addicted to crack cocaine and drugs at 14, 15 years old. I got introduced to marijuana, and I was a smoker from 8 years old. And I was heavy into alcohol and all that my entire life, basically. I wasted 23 years of my life just manifesting cycles, patterns, and karmas from my generational past, like traumas and jealousy. My mom was a very abusive and jealous woman. I would see bloodshed hurt. She would take a chopper into my stepdad's head. I seen that at 5 years old. I would be taking care of my baby sister, and I would see like blood and like bleeding, and it would be stuck in his head. And cops my entire life. And then whenever I'd go visit my father for summer holidays, I would see my dad abuse women and be an alcoholic. So he would like pass out and start fights, drinking at people's houses, at parties, dinner and dances. And he would drink and drive while we're in the car, and he would go 100 kilometers an hour. So it's like I manifested through the subconscious mind all of these traits and emotions. And I started to live this way as I got older, the abuse, the jealousy, the insecurity. I was a narcissist. I was abusive. I was toxic. You know, I was raped when I was 18 years old. I was homeless, like I said, when I was 15 and in drugs. You know, so when you're sharing your story, how you sold yourself to the devil kind of thing, I took that and I felt, you know, I was leading my life to an inevitable death. My spirit was tainted and I had to relearn a lot. But that's the gist of my upbringing. A lot of negativity. It's hard to pinpoint a specific timeline because there's so much back and forth. By the time I was 18 to 20, 23 years old, I've been to jail and holding cells over 10 times. I've been abused and jumped and beat up. So just a lot of cycles that I did not understand how to break. I did not know why I was manifesting and attracting these circumstances. And yeah, it was pretty, pretty difficult, but I always excelled in sports and there was a lot of, you know, plus moments and stuff. But I remember just a lot of pain and suffering and turmoil and trauma and put downs. Yeah.
Let me ask you this, because people ask me the question, you know, when you're referring to when I sold my soul to the devil, is that whole mob story of when I almost made a movie for the mob. A lot of people ask me, would you go back and change it? Would you go back and change that pain you went through? Would you go back and change the trauma, change the all of that, that, you know, subconsciously stayed with me for 15 years, 17 years until I finally discovered what that thing was doing to me. Would you go back and change anything?
I would have listened to the whispers I was always receiving sooner. I was always getting downloads and uploads and whispers my entire life. But the devil within me, I didn't know how to love it. I didn't know how to surrender to my ego. But it was always there. We always have this whisper, this subtle guidance. And if I knew how to do it like I do now after my car accident, I would have listened, you know, because it was always there. But I just chose the other route and it always manifested for me. It always would give me the crack or the cocaine or the mushrooms or the ecstasy or a car accident or abuse or sex or relationships or different types of girls or relationships or buddies to hang out with and parties to go to. I was manifesting all of the subconscious memories of what I was told I was less than. I'm shit. I'm a loser. You know, I was I would say, you know, grade three education. I didn't have the lifestyle to finish school. You know, I was always pulled out and there was so much alienation and custody and child battles going on my entire life and going in front of social workers and child care services and being exported from the police officers to the flight attendants. And this was my whole life. And then different schools, I was always the new kid. I was always the new guy. And I also went to a school that was handicapped and for the hearing impaired. So I had a liking to and an intuition towards people with disabilities. And I learned sign language early on. And I was very intuitive growing up. You know, my family had different religions and they always dabbled in different things. And I understood spirituality and dark energy and magic and stuff like that. So I was very intuitive, especially with all the pain and suffering that I had to go through. You know, and I also suffered with migraine headaches, and I would look out the window and think I'm seeing like asteroids falling down from the sky and UFOs. And I always had this fear of the unknown before. I didn't know, you know, what my life was going to turn into, but I just kept going. I kept pushing forward. You know, I just kept believing in something. I just didn't know how to tap into it.
So tell me what happened the day or the night that you had your near-death experience. What led up to it?
So as I got older, I just became worse. Nothing was ever good enough. I wanted to party hard, and I wanted to drink hard and do drugs hard and be very egotistical, macho, and tough. And so I ended up attracting my thoughts and feelings and emotions. I wake up in the middle of the night and I say, you know, what do I want to do today? You know, and I wanted to party. I was bored. I was like feeling miserable those days. And I had nothing to go for except for, you know, chasing friends, acquaintances that weren't even my friends. And I said that I just wanted to do drugs, alcohol, and have sex with girls. And you know, I'm not afraid to admit these things. I would be the first person to tell my truths now, but that's what I asked for. Next thing you know, I make a couple phone calls, and everything that I wanted came into existence. The girls, the party, the drugs, the alcohol, everything that I wanted except for, you know, the sex part. So while I was at the house, I was getting all the drugs and alcohol that I wanted, but I was feeling bored. I wasn't getting, you know, the excitement and that desire that I was looking for. So I said, you know, I'm going to leave. And, you know, I was asked by a few people, like, are you sure? You know, you just finished, you know, all this cocaine and mushrooms, and, you know, you're on alcohol, you did marijuana and you're smoking. And I'm like, I'm good. You know, I had a high tolerance, right? And it didn't kick in until I got into my car and I said, I'm leaving. I got the keys and I get into my car, and I end up saying to myself, I'm going to drive to this girl's house, and I shoot her a text and I say, hey, where do you live? And she tells me, and I say, okay, I'm on my way. I'll be there in 5 minutes. And I start driving, and I just start getting flooded with all these whispers and downloads and thought patterns and all these lights flashing before my eyes. And before you know it, I was driving that fast in the residential area. I was going about 100 kilometers an hour before I sideswiped two vehicles, and I got confused and lost and dazed. So I forgot where I was going, and I go in circles, and I end up just driving so fast, I black out. I hit two cars. I banged my head on the windshield, and in a daze, I hit even harder on the gas. And I go up and I hit a house going 100 kilometers an hour. So I ejected out of the vehicle head first. And from that instance, I left my body. And right when I hit that house, it was like a bomb went off, and I started hearing voices immediately. Like, what was that? Wake up. And I hear people going down the stairs, but I was done. My body was done. And I didn't realize what it was, but it was my spirit was out of my body, and I was able to listen and observe and notice what's going on around me in different places. I didn't have to go into the house, but it was like I was in tune with the thoughts, feelings, and emotions. I can hear, see, and feel things right away. And so, you know, they go outside and they see my body and they're like, and they're like, what do we do? Oh my God, you know? And when they did the investigation, when they came, took pictures and everything, my body was located on the passenger side of the vehicle. So when they did the investigation, they didn't have solid evidence of who was the driver. They thought someone drove away. And I was diagnosed with brain damage and short-term memory loss. And I had severe, I lost a lot of blood, 50% of my blood. I was done. And the ambulance comes and they start trying to revive me. And all I can see and hear and feel is everyone's emotions. And I can hear them working hard on me, telling, you know, themselves that, oh my God, let's get him back alive. Like, he's losing too much blood. I have shards of glass in my head, in the back of my neck, in my body. And, you know, my car was crushed. I have an SUV. It was an SUV that was just crushed. I hit the, it was a brick, like a concrete home, like the lower half is all concrete. And so I'm watching all this and I'm hovering around and they start taking me to the hospital, but I was able to observe everything. And I even see the investigation too. I'm able to be at all places at once. Like, I can see things in the past and future at once. And it was like I could tap into thoughts and timelines and frequencies and stuff, but I'm following my body to the hospital. And so I go to the hospital and I'm hovering over the ambulance and I can hear phone calls and I can hear police officers and I can hear the ambulance and I can hear them calling the family and going through my wallet. I can see all of this when it wasn't in front of me. And so then as I get to the hospital, I see them rushing me to ICU and, you know, taking care of me. And slowly people start showing up. Like, my mom shows up and sisters, cousins, family members. And before people can speak, I can hear what they're about to say or who they're about to call. And I'm able to tap, I was tapping into, you know, the telephone wire or the phone calls and the frequency leading all the way to the other person on the other line. And I'm still able to do things. As you asked me what else I could do, I'll tell you what else, but those things started to happen. And it was strange because I didn't know what to do with it. I didn't know, you know, what I should do with my spirit, you know. But I would follow my body everywhere for the surgeries. I was going for the for my leg. My leg broke. My lung collapsed. I had a 75% of nerve damage. I was paralyzed on the right side of my body. And so whenever I would go in for surgery, my spirit would follow my body and be present, be around. And I remember being very dehydrated. I needed water. My body was shutting down. I thought I was going to die. The breathing tube that was in me was choking me. And my neck brace had my neck in a position where I wasn't getting good proper airflow. So my spirit came back into my body, gave me the strength. And remember, it felt like it was a ton of bricks. I hit a house, so I couldn't move. I was paralyzed when I woke up. And so, but my spirit gave myself the strength to take off my own neck brace while I was on life support for 2.5 days. I was on life support. But in those days, I took off my neck brace. I even came back into my body to go like this and tell my mom to get me water. I didn't speak, but I, through the mind, I was able to enter my mom's mind and tell her to give me water. And just a few minutes later, she said to the doctors and nurses, my son needs water. So I was able to do these things, certain things, and it would happen. And I still do them. But at that time, I didn't know. It was just natural. It was just like my spirit knew. It was doing all of these things on purpose. And then, do you want me to go into the whole near-death experience?
Yeah. So you're still basically hovering at this point. You haven't left this realm yet. Yeah. So let's go into the part when you actually go to the other side, as they say, sir.
Sure. So when the nurses and the doctors noticed my neck brace came off and my mom giving me water, they started to say that it looks like he's responding. And so you have a decision to make and you should discuss this with the family.
Right.
What do you want to do? And they decided to have a conversation, and they were debating to leave me plugged in or to unplug me. But ultimately they came to the decision to unplug me. And so when my mom came into the room and told the nurses, okay, we decide. So she goes up to the plug in the wall, and I'm watching everything.
Mm-hmm.
And that at that moment, I was confronted with a compelling. I had a compelling to go somewhere that I was longing to go. And I had to surrender and detach. And as I was doing that, I started to just leave automatically, hover and go up. And I was floating up through the hospital, through the ceiling and going up. And as I leave the hospital, I started to see the hospital from a distance. And I say it on other platforms, overview, like the satellite GPS.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see the terrain and you can see everything and you can see the plane. And I just keep going further and further and further. And I get connected to a vortex, like a wormhole. And I didn't know what to do, but it was just taking me. But I was going through these emotions and these feelings, if I should just go and trust, or if I should attach and stay and be in control.
Right.
So there was these moments I was going through, as a spirit of detachment, acceptance, and surrender. And as soon as I just let go of the control and expectation, the trust felt better. It felt good. And it allowed me to go in, and I entered, and it started taking me up slowly. And the more that I started to think and feel about thoughts and emotions and everything that's going on, it started to take me up further and further, faster and faster. And I started to see lights and black and different glimpses. But I started to also see what I was leaving behind, like experiences and stuff. And I started to go faster and faster and faster, really, really fast. And I started to panic a little bit inside. And there was a point where I just didn't know where I was going. I didn't know if it was going to stay black or if it was ever going to go become white, because you always hear stories of mm-hmm. a white light. And these things were in my consciousness and my awareness. And I was expecting, but I had to learn to not expect in this time frame. And when I finally had surrendered into the fear, the darkness, and learned to trust in the darkness, there was a stillness and a calmness of trust, and it slows down, and then there this white light, glowing light starts to come through the darkness, seeping through. And I'm like, and I relax and I surrender and I'm going upright and I go towards it, and all becomes white. And I said, I thought to myself, where am I going? Right? Like what's going to be after this? And behind me is all black. And in front of me is just white light. And I hear a voice saying, I hear like, he's here. Welcome. What do you want to do? And I'm hearing whispers. And I'm welcomed in. And as I go in, I see angelic beings, white light beings. And they're in their natural state, bowing down, and they're in a surrender essence and the mood and the compassion and the love is all calm and surrender and welcoming and loving. And, you know, I felt like this is where I belong. This is where I came from. I'm home. This is my people. Right. And then there was another large being that was about 25 to 100 times bigger than the other humanoid light beings that were there. And he lifted up his head and said, "What do you want to do? What are you going to do?" And at that moment, I seen my life review. And I knew I had a decision to make, and I confronted my life, and I seen every turmoil, every suffering, but not only what was done to me, but what I've done to people and how I handled everything and how I judged everything and my perspective and the perception that I was coming from. The way I seen everything, the way I left everything, the way I believed in everything, the way I felt and thought about everything, all the emotions, all the encounters, everything. Like you hear when people talk about, you know, the UFOs took me and showed me everything that I needed to see. It was like that. And I'm telling you, like, that emotion of being welcomed and I didn't have to go back, I was home, was so powerful. It's so easy to just stay, but I knew I had an oath and dedication to make, a sacrifice to make that I didn't fulfill. And although it looked easy, when we're on Earth, this physical realm it's very hard. It's very hard. And so I turned around and I was asked, "What do you want to do? What are you going to do?" And I said, "I want to go back." And I felt emotional, you know, and because I knew that it wasn't finished, but I didn't know how it was going to be done, but it was an oath and it was a promise. It was a sacrifice to God and to my higher self. And as soon as I made that commitment and that dedication and oath, I was welcomed back. And the same way that I entered, I went back and I started going down back into the black. And I go all the way and I show up into the atmosphere again. And I come down to the atmosphere and through the terrain, and I see everything from a distance, and I see the hospital, and I start going back through the hospital, back into the ICU, and my mom unplugs me. And right when that happened, it took about 15 minutes before I physically woke up. But when I woke up, I was back into pain and suffering and judgment and ego and justifying and resentment and condemning and crucification and blame. And it was crazy. But I woke up and I lift up my body. I try to, and I look at my leg and I self-realize everything. And I said, "What happened to my leg?" And that's what my first words were. And my sister and my mom look at me, and I can feel and hear and see their thoughts, feelings, and emotions. And before they speak, I can hear, "Oh, that's what he has to say. He's back." And I didn't care. I was just resentful. I was angry and full of hate and rage and blame. And I wanted to just take everything swept under the carpet and sweep it back out and confront the world with my rage and my judgment and my anger and blame and tell them and crucify them. Cause those were the same people that wished death on me. They wished death. Months before I died, they said, you know, "You should get hit by a car. You should get run over by a bus." And I don't blame them, because I was so strong-willed and I was so defiant and so angry that I could put people in that state of fear that I would make them say things and the actions that I took to make my own mother say, you know, I wish you died. I wish you died in my stomach. You know, when I drank bleach, when your dad was kicking me in the stomach, when I drank bleach, you should have died. I wish you were never born, and you should go die. And these things happened just months before my car accident. And so I had all these memories and all these curses. And even my dad spat in my face and said, you're going to die a lonely man, before I died. So the fact that my dad was in the hospital, not in the hospital room, but I could feel the energy and I can feel and hear everyone praying and whispering. I knew what people were saying. I even spoke it to each person. My stepsister would come and tell me her prayers when I was on life support. And when I woke up, I told her, I know this is what you said exactly. And they were all in shock, even my sister, my mom, but I still had this overwhelming blame of, yeah, I hear it all. I know you guys want forgiveness. I know you guys are here now reaping what you sowed and vice versa. But I just, it was so hard and difficult, the rage. So it wasn't like I came back and it was easy for me to change. I came back into the same thickness, but it was harder because I had pain, I had brain damage, I had memory loss, I was diagnosed, I had nurses and doctors telling me that I wouldn't walk the same, talk the same, your leg's broken, you're not gonna leave here, you're gonna stay here, you have blood clots, you have this, you have that. But while I was so toxic and negative, I had an innate knowing of, no, you are powerful. You are a creator. You can't, that's not true. And it was hard to tap in, but I would get these downloads that were very loud, like in my ear, in my face, like, no, show them, raise your blood pressure and show them you can raise the blood pressure machine. And I would do it. And the blood pressure machine would raise up and they would get scared, or, you know, certain things like, you know, telling the nurses that, no, I know my bones are healing. And they would laugh at me and say, you hit a house. You don't know how severe your car accident is. Like, you should not be alive. It's a miracle you're alive. And, you know, doctors would come in, roll their eyes and leave. And they would just have this expectation that he's just another patient. He's going to be here for a long, long time. And he's just ignore him kind of thing. But sometimes I'd get nurses saying, shh, you know, we don't talk about that, but we've heard stories like this before. And, but I walked out of the hospital in 6 days and I told myself that I'm going to heal my bones. And I would go into my cells and I would go into my body. I would go into my bones and I would fuse it together. I would visualize it fusing and I would feel it and come back and I would know that's done. And I would go back into certain blood clots and I would release my blood. I would be able to go into certain things the same way I would go into the telephone wires or go into people's thoughts and tell them what to do or how to, you know, certain things that I even did afterwards, you know, we're able to do, we're able to heal. But it takes a lot of, like, my main thing is in the pain and suffering, in the toxicity, it's a contradiction. There's a lot of people, I know you've had amazing guests, like some of my favorites on your show, you know, Billy Carson and Dr. Joe Dispenza. And I don't know if you've had Tony Robbins yet, but they speak these things. And it's like, I'm going against some of these things, like being able to do things in the negativity. And I don't want to advocate being negative. I'm not saying be negative. I'm saying there's a way to use that negativity and still be able to do powerful things for positive outcomes. And so I didn't know what I was doing, but then as I was going through this whole process, and you know, you've talked to a lot of people, there's a whole process to, you know, becoming to a point where you need to become. I had to go through it all. I had to rewrite my destiny, even you know, gurus read my book. You know, they'd say, you're going to do this. You're like this. You're like this. You're like this. You know, you drink and drive. You're going to die. And this was told before my car accident. You know, my destiny was written, but I made a decision to rewrite my destiny, to change, to quantify my life experience, and to prove it, like breaking generational curses, being able to manifest and attract, being able to, you know, step out of my comfort zone and come off of all the pharmaceuticals and cold turkey, quit the drugs. But it was a journey. I had to catch pneumonia 4, 5, 6 times. I had pneumonia. I had to sacrifice my own life for death, but for the right way. The same pharmaceuticals that were keeping me alive, I had to choose to flush down the toilet and sacrifice, make that dedication and oath to choose the spirit, you know, to live a different way. And when I did, those sacrifices is what made me change my life. And so, you know, being able to come over criminal records and stop going to jail and getting into road rage and fighting and being abusive and a narcissist, you know, I hear people talking about narcissists. I was beyond a narcissist. I was worse. Mm-hmm. I was a bad guy.
So that's a pretty remarkable story. When you came back, Malcolm, how long before you started to see a shift in this anger, before you started to release a lot of this anger, a lot of the fear, a lot of the programming that you had gotten over the course of your life? Because, I mean, those first 23 years, there's a lot of hard wiring going on in your head, a lot. And there's nothing like a near-death experience to shake up the etch-a-sketch a bit, if you will. But how long did it take for you?
So I would question myself, like, why am I not changing? Why is this so hard? Why is this rock bottom happening? I just want to kill myself. I wanted to commit suicide. I debated hanging myself on the tree or taking all the pharmaceuticals. I was taking 30 to 40 pharmaceuticals a day. I was on sleeping pills. I was on amitriptyline, something for the brain. When you're in the psych ward, you have to take something for your brain. And I was on tramadol. I was on Percocet, morphine, oxycodone, and they were always increasing it. I had an infinite amount of prescriptions. So if I go to the doctor, I was on a special thing because I had so much that happened to me. I could go and be like, I need 1,000, and they would give me 1,000. If I wanted 500 milligrams from 20 milligrams, they would give it to me, and I would take advantage of the system. Absolutely. I would take advantage of the system, and I was using the drug addiction that I had, and I had an addictive personality, and I was still, you know, trading, you know, things and doing things and, you know, drinking and driving. I would get susceptible to doing things, hanging out with girls. Yes, I would do good, like go to college. And so I was doing counterintuitive things. I was doing one good thing and one bad thing at the same time. So I decided to go back to college because I was covered under insurance from the car insurance, from the car accident. So they gave me about $23,000 to live on for 3 years. And I'm like, and I went through that very fast. And so what happened was I tried to get more. They wouldn't give me more. They said, you're in college now, so we shouldn't be supporting you. I said, what do you want me to do? Leave school so then I can stay in the system and you guys will give me money? I'm trying to benefit my life here. I'm trying to put myself through school. They had to start me back from grade 6 because of my educational level, right? I had nothing growing up as a kid. I was, you know, I was abused and all this since I was a child, you know? So I didn't even complete grade 3, 4, 5, 6 properly. You know, I left school like after grade 6. So I have no grade 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 education. So anyways, I had to put myself through college. So I was manifesting, like you hear people with, Asperger's or, you know, syndromes, and they're able to see images and shapes and numbers. So I was able to do that, pull in information and remember what we were learning in school. And I passed with 96 to 100%. And I got all the way through to grade 10. But at the same time, I was hanging out with college girls, going for drinks, drinking and driving, dropping them home, being a macho guy, and going on the highway, not speeding necessarily, but I would be on alcohol. So my spirit would remind me, be like, what are you doing? And I would black out, just instantly black out. And all of a sudden, when I would get that whisper, I would black out. So every time I would do something bad, I would black out. And so I would black out, and that blackout, when I would wake up from it, the cops are banging, it's on the highway, I'm at the intersection, people are honking at me, and I would wake up and the cops would be furious and they'd say, you're lucky that I'm not taking you to jail, but I'm taking your car away. And they would be so mad and aggressive. They'd be like, you walk home, we're taking your car to the impound. Your car keys, what are they doing on the passenger side? And I would say, in my mind, I'm like, oh my gosh, like, what happened? I wouldn't know. My keys, you know, just like how my body was found and my neck brace was taken off. So these things would happen. And I would say, I would walk home and I'd be in this stillness of surrender. And I'd be like, that's the whisper. So more bad would happen. I would do more rock bombs. Or if I would start, I was still smoking. It was hard for me to quit smoking. My car accident happened when I was 23. I didn't quit smoking officially till I was 27. I would smoke 2 packets of cigarettes a day.
This is interesting, because a lot of near-death experiencers, when they come back, it takes a little bit of time to gradually kind of get into their new reality, if you will. After that experience is a very jarring experience. But for you, it seems like it got worse. You kind of fighting what you went through. To my understanding, near-death experiences are wake-up calls. There's whispers, there's taps on the shoulder, there's a tap, you know, push on the shoulder until finally a sledgehammer hits you, or you hit a house at 100 kilometers an hour to wake you up, because your path you're on is not good. When you came back, you didn't remember. You remembered the life review. You remembered all this stuff, right? But you were just so far removed from that, even still, that yes. You still kept going down a dark path, yes. Even after the enlightenment of a near-death experience.
Yes, I was still abusive domestically. Mm-hmm. I was still toxic towards my children. I didn't know how to parent. I had to learn and discover what a parent was, because my dad was abusive. Sure. My mom was abusive. True. I didn't know anything. I had to learn how I had to remember, you know, I went to social worker, psychologist, but it was like, I can read their mind. And because I could read their mind and I can hear, see, and feel their thoughts, feelings, and emotions while they're working with me, I knew what they were thinking, and they couldn't figure me out. The fact that they were giving me assignments and things and techniques, I was like, they're not going to be able to understand me because I'm reading their mind while they're trying to figure me out. So it was like, I was already 10 steps ahead, but I was still 10 steps behind in my personal life.
So at what point did this start turning around for you? Because you don't seem to be that guy now.
Right. I know. So like all the things that would happen, I literally had to fight my way through the sacrifice. I had to remind and remember what a sacrifice was. And the sacrifice to me, just for you and your audience, is the fact that I was in front of source and I had to surrender and remind and be a soul. I died to realize I wish I could have done it again differently, but I'm here and we forget. So I had to remember that I have this ability, that I died and I came back consciously. I chose to come back. So that reminder of remembering standing there as a spirit, you know, repenting. I had to repent and I had to surrender and I had to dedicate my life. That remembering put fear in me, but it was not fear of God. It was fear of, if I don't do this sacrifice, what rock bottom is going to happen next? So I wouldn't know. So I would smoke cigarettes and I'd be like, okay, so if I don't quit, I'm trying to quit. I want to, it's hard. I'm smoking, then kill me. So I'd say, kill me. I'm going to die. I'm going to sacrifice my death again, and I'm going to catch pneumonia. So I had to give it some substance. I had to give it some tangible and practical, something real. So I said, if I don't quit, I'm going to die. Die for what? What am I going to die for? I'm not going to live the life I'm supposed to live. I'm not going to change my life. I'm not going to become a better father, a better boyfriend, a better person, get better jobs, keep a job, you know, learn how to love, learn how to forgive, learn how to, you know, forgive my rapist. You know, I said, nothing's going to change for me. I'm going to catch pneumonia and die. And so I caught pneumonia. And so I'm shaking and I'm smoking and I'm catching pneumonia and I start coughing and my lungs fill up with so much fluid and I'm slowly dying. And weeks go by and I go to the nurses and the doctors and my ex, she takes me to all these clinics and they're diagnosing me and they don't know what's wrong with me. They're giving me stuff for bronchitis. And they're giving me all these things and I'm taking the wrong medications, the wrong puffers for bronchitis for several weeks. My lungs are at capacity. So if I cough, I'm filling up glasses like this full of liquid. Wow. And this is happening and I'm dying. So finally, my ex takes me from the tub cold, like I'm laying in the tub, can't breathe. Liquid is just pouring out of me. And she drags me into the car, drags me to the hospital. And the nurses are furious. They're like, you're dying. You're killing yourself. What is this puffer? What is this? That's for bronchitis. You have pneumonia. And they're mad. They're literally yelling at me. And I'm like dying. And I'm like, I don't, you know, and I'm going blue. And they start, you know, draining everything out. And so that was another rock bottom. And so that reminded me and it became harder. So I would go through that. And then I was still smoking. I would stop at halfway and I would, the whisper would come up like, okay. And I'd butt it out. And then that would be like, I was talking to God. I was talking to my spirit. And spirit was watching me. And then the next one, I'd be like, okay, I'm doing this. I can do it. And I would take four puffs, stop. And I still had pneumonia. I was still catching it. I was still getting in fights, going to jail. And I said, okay, if I don't stop going to jail, something else is going to happen to me. I'm going to sacrifice. What's going to happen to me? I'm going to lose my kids. And I said it, I spoke it into existence. And me and my ex, we got in an altercation, domestic, all the nasty stuff. I go to jail and she files, you know, the emergency protection order and all these emergency things. And I get my kids taken away from me, child this, I'm in jail. And I'm in jail and I'm laying on the floor on the concrete with two bunkies and I go through the whole process of jail and I'm saying in my mind, wow, I attracted this. I asked for it. I'm creating my reality. I spoke this into existence. What should I do? Well, you got to now change it. You got to bend this reality. How? You're going to now go into the minds of the police officers. You're going to go into the minds of the judge in advance and you're going to send a signal of you are changed, your peace and harmony. They believe in you. You're not going to go through these struggles. So while I'm in jail, I'm using my technique of what I do out of body and all the spiritual stuff. But I have to do it for real. I can't be a fraudster because remember when I'm manifesting from dark energy, but I'm trying to get a good outcome, right? So I had to prove it. So I do it. And an officer comes like a few hours later, Malcolm, right? And I go, the judge would like to see you. And I'm like, what? But 2.5 days, right? Just like my life support was 2.5 days. 2.5 days, they call me and I go in front of the judge and the judge sees the light in me that I'm projecting because I don't want to project darkness and evilness and aggression, you know? And they request me to go to anger management and all this. So it's through that I went to two. The second one was by choice, but I went to a 14-week anger management program with all men, 25 different men, and I got to see perspective, real perspective. Plus, you know, I went to another program with 25 different women. I got welcomed. I was allowed. I manifested. I said, it would be nice in my spirit that I get welcomed, be the only man for the first time welcomed in an all women's program, anger management. So I got to witness domestic violence, abuse, like evil, bad things. And I got to listen to so many different women's stories, so many different men's stories, how nasty and abusive and toxic, and we were learning. And then I also had to go through life. I had to go through life, not only my own life experiences, but just the relearning of boundaries, not to justify. So it was a lot. And that's just two areas, you know, to break cycles and patterns. You have to pattern recognize everything. My abusive tendencies like rage and road rage. How did I change that? That's a whole other story. If I go through each sure. one, mm-hmm. it would be a long
hours.
Time.
It'd be hours. Yeah. It'd be hours. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Well, the near death experience, in a sorts, was a catalyst for you, but a catalyst that was a long tail, took a while for it to come up. But you started to break through help of spirit, through help of the whispers and all this kind of stuff. You started to slowly break the patterns to get to where you are today. But that near death experience was kind of the catalyst for all of that in a way.
Then I start to realize what I was doing. I was premonizing and I was remote viewing and I was affecting free will because I would end up getting jobs that I'd never had in my life before. Because of my education, I was never able to become a manager. I was never able to be a supervisor of a franchise. And I would do these things, go apply for jobs that were for manager roles. And I'm like, I can do this. I'm going to do it. And I'd go and I would lie on my resume that I have all the credentials and stuff. And I would remote view into the office of them looking at all the resumes. And mine was at the bottom. And I would make them take my resume from the bottom to the top and believe in it, trust in the process, believe that I can really do this for my life experience, that I could be a manager of 30, 40 different employees. And I would get a phone call 2 days later, would like to interview. I would get the job and I would realize that we are powerful, that we could do things, but you have to prove it to yourself too. You'd have to show up and be this person you're trying to become and not slap your spirit or God in the face that, you know, you're getting this second chance. Are you going to go drink and drive, stop at the intersection, have cops bang on the door? No, like, next time if I black out, I might never wake up. So it was like, it had to be scary enough. If your life is already scary and you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, what are you doing to change? What are you doing in the fear, in the dark? What are you doing with your suffering? Are you suffering or are you using that as a catalyst, like you're saying, to reinvent your life through it all, through the hardship, right?
Malcolm, your story has been so inspiring, man. I appreciate you sharing it. I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all of my guests.
Yes.
What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Being able to see through what fulfillment really is when you can commit and sacrifice and stay consistent no matter how hard it gets. That to me is fulfilling.
If you had a chance to go back in time and talk to little Malcolm, what advice would you give him?
It's going to be easy, but you're going to go through a lot of hardship. You're not going to have your mom and dad. You're not going to have a lot of the things, coping mechanisms and stuff, but you have me, you have a spirit. And I would have told myself to trust that you are a spirit.
How do you define God or source?
Surrender, admittance, and compassion and forgiveness.
What is love?
Love is through the hardship, you know, through thick and thin, through the ups and downs and rocky roads and rock bottoms, and still learning to love the enemy within and the fraudulence within, and facing the fraudulence and still loving the devil within. So then the devil can serve your higher conscious awareness. The ego, you can transform the ego and make your ego serve your conscious awareness, your subconscious to serve your higher conscious awareness.
What is the ultimate purpose of life?
Perseverance and learning and realizing that our spirit is the one that's here as the student of life. And we don't realize that. We think we're the student, us, mind, body. But it's the opposite. It's like we need to surrender in the fact that it's the soul, it's the spirit and the hardship. We got to realize to build that relationship with our fears, with our egos and emotions, thoughts, feelings. We're not it. We're not that. That's not what we are. You know, and, you know, I would say that, you know.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
Guided intelligence. You can just search guided intelligence on social media or my website, guidedintelligence.ca, or by name, Malcolm Nair.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Before you forgive yourself and before you love yourself and go to the light, realize you can't have light without the dark. All light comes through the dark. So you have to be able to sit in your own pain and suffering and learn how to be comfortable being uncomfortable in the dark. Face your fraudulence and sit in that vulnerability, sit in the shame, sit in the guilt, and learn how to do it differently. You can transmute that stuff by being able to sit in it and go through it and respect yourself after you've done the work. It's hard for us to stare at ourselves in the mirror and self-reflect and look at the blame and look at all the shame, look at all the guilt, you know, and accept it. And look at how far we've come and bless it, thank it, thank the darkness, thank the hardships. Look at it as a blessing. We're here to receive those as blessings. It's not what happens to us. It's happening for us. So you can love the pain. You can love the injuries. You can love the hurt going on in you. And that's what we need to learn how to do.
Malcolm, I appreciate you being on the show and sharing your story with all of us and your inspiration as well. So thank you, my friend. Appreciate you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate you.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey. And don't forget to subscribe.